Hello, I'm Ames Asbell. I'm the Associate Professor of Viola at Texas State University in San Marcos, Texas, in the United States. Today I'm going to share with you a presentation on tango techniques and repertoire for viola. I played in a tango band for many years and got to really know the style and really enjoy it and think there's some really fun repertoire for the viola that we can explore. So today I'd like to share with you a little bit of my history in playing tango, an overview of the tango, its history and stylistic periods. We'll go over some of the common performance techniques for playing tango, and then I'll give you an idea of just a few pieces that you might want to look for in this style. I have a slide presentation to share with you, so I'll share my screen and we will get started with tango performance techniques and repertoire. First, my life as a tanguera. Tanguera is a female who, typically that word refers to a dancer, but I was a performer in a mixed group, a group that had a string quartet, accordion, bass, and piano. I had a good friend who was a composer who heard the music of Piazzolla and was bitten by the tango bug and decided he wanted to compose tangos. He was playing in a band at the time, and his band did not want to learn these new compositions and this new style. So he decided to arrange his pieces for string quartet, bass, accordion, piano, the group that I mentioned. And we all got together and played through the music to see if we would like it. And we all did. We loved it and we had a great time. We decided to form a band and we played almost exclusively tango music, this band, for about 5 years in the late 1990s and early 2000s. We recorded 5 albums, which you see the little squares are all of our album covers. We've gone on to record a couple more albums that were not strictly in the tango style, but those are our 5 tango records. And down at the bottom left of your screen, you'll see a picture of us performing in Buenos Aires. Sorry, this performance is actually in Rosario in Argentina. We also played in Buenos Aires for the 5th World Tango Summit, I think it was called. So this is me actually with the short hair playing the viola. And then right after that in 2001, the film director Richard Linklater, who is also from Austin, Texas, where my band was formed, decided that he liked our music. He used to come and listen to us play in the clubs and decided he wanted to feature our music on the soundtrack of his film Waking Life. So our music was all over the soundtrack, and then we also were in a short scene, a couple of short scenes, one at the beginning of the movie and one at the end. And so I just want to share with you a little bit of what my band sounded like. This is a rehearsal scene from the beginning of the movie. I'm at the top right of your screen with the shorter dark hair. And this is the introduction to the movie, the opening credits. Here comes the viola. That's our band leader, Glover.
Rock out. Rock and roll. Low string. Dig in.
And viola solo. Thank you. So those are some of the techniques that we're going to talk about a little bit later. Excuse me, I have to figure out how to work my presentation. There we go. Sorry about that. So that was a lot of fun and a great time, but I'm really grateful to have been introduced to the style of Argentine tango, the tango nuevo style that we played in, and to have had the opportunity to travel to Argentina on several occasions and to play both feature performances at the conference that we did and also command performances for the Astor Piazzolla Foundation. So let's dive into the history. So the origins of Argentine tango. The tango was born in the working class areas of Buenos Aires in Argentina and Montevideo in Uruguay, which are on either side of a river delta, the Rio de la Plata, which is a river that flows down from the north out to the coast there and has a very large river delta. There, in the late 1800s, there was a huge influx of immigrants from various locations that brought with them different styles of music and different languages. And to this day, Buenos Aires is a very cosmopolitan city with people from all over the world. Lots of Europeans emigrated there over the years, as well as lots of people from West Africa, which brought with them the African candombe rhythm, which is a bum, 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 bum rhythm. There was also the influence of the Cuban habanera, which is bum, da, 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 a similar rhythm. The Spanish zarzuela, which was a kind of a storytelling type of song, and then the European salon music. It was very common for people to go between Buenos Aires and Paris in the late 1800s and early 1900s, and other European centers, of course, but Paris was the main city that was an exchange there. So lots of music coming back and forth and lots of rhythmic influences on the tango. The old style of tango, the Guardia Vieja, was from about 1895 to 1925. This is the old school tango. These are fast, they're in 2/4 time, very simple arrangement. They usually have a marcato, just a very accented on the beat accompaniment, or the habanera that I mentioned before, that da 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 da. The first tango that was published ever was in 1897. And then the first one that was recorded was in 1903. And it was a tune that you may find familiar, El Choclo. And I'll play you a little bit of the original recording from 1903, recorded in Paris. You hear that habanera accompaniment. Ba-da-ba-ba. So that recording done in 1908, just 5 years after the song was written in Paris. So the earliest tango bands had flute, violin, and guitar. If they were lucky enough, these were, if you would, playing out on the street in the warehouse districts down by the river in Argentina, these were mobile groups that would move around. If you happened to be in a place with a piano, obviously you could use a piano, but it was not always a requirement. Something in 1910, something happened that changed the course of the tango forever, and that was that the bandoneon arrived, this kind of accordion-like instrument with buttons and strange keys. Is a very difficult instrument to learn. It arrived from a factory in Germany, was shipping these bandoneons down to Buenos Aires and Montevideo, and they were quickly adopted by tango musicians and became a staple in the tango literature. Tango was very popular. A wave of tango mania swept across Paris in 1913, and people were enamored of the tango. And in 1916 was when the first typical orchestration became standardized, what they called the orquesta típica, which became two bandoneons, two violins, piano, and bass. And that was a standard instrumentation for quite a while in the tango. That's a bandoneon. If you're not familiar with one, you kind of pull it out and squeeze it, and we'll see one in a video in a minute. Very, very difficult to learn. The Guardia Nueva brought with it some changes. There were some changes in the tango style. We went from a fast 2-4 to a very steady 4-4. They actually had a name for this, El Cuatro. The tangos became a little bit slower, a little bit more complex. There was more interesting counterpoint, and the melodies and the harmonies were more fully developed, and it just became a much more interesting style of music. There was an emergence of two different styles. There was that rhythmic style, which was more like the old school tangos, but then there would be much more singing, lyrical, flexible rubato styles that began to develop. There was a very famous violinist at the time named Julio De Caro, who had his own band, and he established the typical sound for this era. And one of the things that was really interesting that emerged during this era were the instrumental style. There were lots of different string effects. So I'm going to play a little clip for you, and you're going to hear, if you listen, some kind of scraping sounds of the bow hair behind the bridge. And then you'll also hear some big glissandi. Let's listen to Julio De Caro. So, along with pizzicati and other effects that began to develop, this became sort of a real musical language of tango, the string effects. In the 1930s, because of the advent of radio and film, tango became a worldwide sensation, and one of its greatest stars was Carlos Gardel. You may know his tango canción or his tango song, Por una cabeza. It's a very famous tango song, probably the most famous one that has been in movies and commercials, and it's been heard everywhere. And that was written in 1935. And unfortunately, Carlos Gardel was killed the next year in a plane crash. So we lost what would have been, I think, a much bigger influence and legend in that time. Then the golden age of tango. During this period, in the mid-30s to the mid-50s, this featured the rise of the Perón family, Juan and Evita Perón. So the economy was improved in Argentina, the middle class was growing, and tango was everywhere. It became really the soundtrack of life. The thing to do on a weekend afternoon was to go out to a big hall, to what it's called a milonga. You would take your lunch, you would take the whole family, and there would be a band playing all afternoon. You'd dance, you'd hang out. That was the normal entertainment of the day. The ensembles got larger and larger and larger. The arrangements got more and more complex. The harmonies became more complex. The music continued to have more and more rubato. And the pinnacle of the Golden Age style was Aníbal Troilo's orchestra. We'll see a video clip of his orchestra in a minute. This began the transition to a more concert style of tango, and a later style called the Tango Nuevo, which is what Piazzolla represents and what my band played. This Osvaldo Pugliesi and Rocío Salgán, those two composers really also, along with Piazzolla, led the charge to the transition to the concert style. And until about 1955, when rock and roll came along, tango ruled Argentina. It was the just absolutely the soundtrack of the culture. So we've been talking a lot about violin effects. Well, when did the viola get to tango? You might be wondering, because this is a viola festival after all. So for a while, no violas in the tango. In 1929, this is a chart of Pugliesi's orchestra and what were the instrumentations. So in 1929, no violas. We had two bandoneons, a piano, two violins, and double bass. By 1939, Pugliesi's orchestra had three bandoneons, three violins, it's getting bigger, and two vocalists. In 1951, this is the pinnacle of the Golden Age style. We had four bandoneons, a piano, four violins, finally Viola gets to join the mix. a double bass, two vocalists, and a presenter. That's what the PRES is, a presenter. So it was a really big show at the time. As we go on and continue past the end of the golden age into more modern times, you can see that the orchestra stayed really big and the viola remains a part of the tango orchestra. And you'll see 1975 to 1993, that's because Pugliese's orchestra went for a very long time. And as the orchestras got bigger and bigger, there might even be two cellos or two violas in the mix. And here's a video. We'll get to watch a little video of Troilo's orchestra. Now, Troilo's orchestra is significant because Astor Piazzolla was actually a member of his orchestra for a while. And also, it went on for years and years. This clip was from a concert in 1972 in the Teatro Colón, which is the big famous hall in Buenos Aires. So listen for these things. At the beginning, the strings will be doing the marcato accompaniment, straight four. You'll hear el cuatro in four. Then there's a piano solo. You'll hear some cantando singing styles. You'll hear a pizzicato accompaniment. There's a big cello solo. But listen to how much flexibility in tempo there is. There's Troilo playing the bandoneon right in the front. We'll see him back in a moment. And look at the size of the string section. And two cellos, there are two violas seated behind them, and a bunch of violins. So with that much flexibility and tempo, it's really chamber music, even in that big of a group. So the Tango Nuevo style, or Nuevo Tango, you will hear it pronounced both ways, was from 1955 until the present time. This is even more slow tempos, even more crazy dramatic rubatos, extremes of everything, dynamics, articulation. Lots of different instruments were used at this time. Sometimes my tango band had a singer. Sometimes we had a clarinet player. We would mix it up a lot. And again, Pugliese and Salgan and Piazzolla. Piazzolla is noteworthy because he represents the synthesis, the truth synthesis of tango and classical composition. If you're interested in more contemporary composers, you can check out Damian Bolotin or Sonia Posetti. They're kind of rock stars of the new Nuevo Tango. Now we have to talk about Astor Piazzolla because he just turned, or would have turned, 100 just this past month. March 11th, 2021 would have been his 100th birthday. And my favorite quote from Piazzolla is, "For me, tango was always for the ear rather than the feet. It started out as a dance form, but really it's a concert art form, and it was for Piazzolla." So he was the son of Italian immigrants. He was born in Buenos Aires and grew up in New York. His father gave him a bandoneon at age 8, and he began to learn that crazy instrument. He started to play piano. He was playing tango professionally at 11. His dad would take him to the clubs. He was playing Bach preludes and fugues on the piano. He was really learning, all coming at his craft from both sides. At only 17, he was asked to join Troilo's orchestra as the fourth bandoneonist, and they kept him on as arranger for several years. In 1944, Troilo started to worry that Piazzolla's kind of crazy harmonic compositional ideas were going to make his music a little less popular, maybe. So they parted ways, and Piazzolla started his own band. He worked hard and saved up enough money to study with the composer Alberto Ginastera. And in 1949, he wrote his first piece for viola. It's called Dos Piezas Breves for viola and piano. One movement is Noche, and the second movement is Tanguano. So it's a tango. He was already writing tango, kind of starting to synthesize at the time. In 1953, he won an award, the Fabian Savitsky Award. And the prize for that award was that he got to go to Paris for a year and study with Nadia Boulanger, which changed his life. He was trying to write these kind of, you know, classical compositions, and she heard that he was going out at night and playing tango in the clubs. And so he came in one day and she asked him about it, and he was kind of sheepish about it. And she said, "Hey, well, what is Piazzolla? Play me Piazzolla." And so he played a tango for her, and she said, "That's it. That's you. That's what you do. Do that and never turn back." And so he did, and he really learned how to put his classical education together with the tango style. The other piece we play for viola is Le Grand Tango, which was written for Rostropovich for cello. But when that was published, it was published with a viola part. So I don't know if it was his publisher's idea or Piazzolla's idea. I've never been able to find that out. But that piece, since the beginning, has been published for viola, which I think, you know, it's intended for viola, and we play it. There's been a new edition made several years ago that corrected a lot of the printing mistakes that were in the original viola part. So there's a good edition out, and I encourage everyone to check out both of those pieces. Now, you're ready to learn some tango effects? What I'm going to teach you is what I learned when I was in Buenos Aires from Mauricio Marcelli. Mauricio Marcelli was in Pugliese's band for many years. And also I learned from Ramiro, I can't speak today, Gaggio, Ramiro Gaggio. He wrote a method book called El Violín en el Tango in 2011. We're still waiting for the viola in tango, but we'll get it. And Ramiro was a part of a great band called El Arranque that was active in Buenos Aires for many years. I also would encourage you, if you're interested in delving deeper, there's a wonderful book published by Oxford University Press called Tracing Tangueros by Casey Link and Kristen Wendland. They're really, really wonderful. And there are also lots of YouTube resources. As we go through the slides, though, you're going to see these little manuscript images. Those are from my book from Mauricio Marcelli. You'll notice at the top, it says violin. When I first met him, he took one look at me, my viola, and he kind of scoffed, and he said, "Oh, viola can't play tango. The viola is not a tango instrument." And then by the end of the time we were working with him, he was like, "Yeah, it's okay. The viola can play the tango." So that's why we're here today. So we were talking about El Cuatro, and obviously rhythm is most important in tango. So we're going to learn first about a couple of rhythmic styles. So marcato, you heard the violins playing just this style, or in the excerpt we heard from Troilo, which is a song called Danzarine. That's marcato. The marcato, accompaniment marcato style, we use colle bowing. It's not meant to be your most beautiful sound. It's meant to be percussive. So, and I should have said, if you'd like to, grab your viola and try these out. Just marcato, colle at the frog. Then also there's a syncopated accompaniment that we have to learn. There's two styles of syncopated or accompaniment or kind of rhythm bass that we learn. One is a tierra, which is on the beat. One, two, three, four. And sometimes we leave out the downbeat, though we might play with a rest on the downbeat. One, two, three, four, one. You'll hear that type of rhythm very commonly. And also anticipado, anticipado, anticipating or coming before the beat. So you might hear one, two, three, so we anticipate, but we don't back away from the beat. We play through the downbeat. And there are any number of any permutation that you can think of syncopation that you'll hear it in the tango. Another really important rhythmic aspect of the tango is what we call 3-3-2, the formula 3-3-2. 3 plus 3 plus 2 is a way of dividing the eight notes, the eight eighth notes in a 4-4 bar. So if we're playing 1, 2, 3, 4, and we want to play eighth notes, we might play 1, 2, 3. You'll notice that I'm playing the accented notes heavy with the down bow, and then the up bows, the other notes are up bow and light. So I end up going down, up, up, down, up. That's very, 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 very typical accompaniment in tango. I spent many hours of my life playing 3 plus 3 plus 2. And this comes from the habanera rhythm and the tresillo rhythm. The tresillo, this is exactly the a translation of the tresillo rhythm that came from West Africa. So arrastre, this is a fun one. This is arrastre means drag. So it is an anticipation to a strong downbeat, and we might play, it might be written, you'll see in Marcelli's manuscript here, but it might be played. One of the most famous examples of arrastre is in Astor Piazzolla's very famous tune, Buenos Aires Hora Cero, Buenos Aires Zero Hour, which has this bass line. So anytime you do that short glissando into a downbeat, then that's an arrastre. The bottom example is a good one too. Sometimes you'll hear it that way. And sometimes they will also come into it by moving the bow or sweeping the bow across the string. I've heard this called most commonly cepillo, means to brush. So you'll hear that glissando and sweeping the bow closer to you to make that kind of brushing sound. This is the most famous tango effect. This is called chicharra, which means cicadas, or lija, which is sandpaper. Sometimes you'll actually see sandpaper written in the music, but it's usually notated with little X's in the music. And what you do is you put your bow into your hand. You just kind of, when you're holding your bow, you grab it, put the bow into the hand, and put your index finger along the top of the bow. And then you will play on the strings behind the bridge, actually on the winding, where this thread is winding on your bottom of your string here. And you'll play them in the middle string. You have to experiment on your instrument to see which one sounds best. And then you'll play a short rhythmic pattern, like maybe. That's what you heard us doing at the beginning of our rehearsal clip in Waking Life. Or you could do, any rhythmic pattern you could think of, or you can even do as in the Julio De Caro. Sometimes just making that sound is a fun thing to do. That was one thing I really enjoyed in our tango group, is the freedom to experiment with these techniques and just kind of put them in and try different things. But the chicharra is really a fun one. Really a great one. You get this kind of vibrating sound. Latigo, this one's really fun. Latigo means whip, and you just literally do this. You whip the hip, whip the glissando up as high as you can. Normally there's not a pitch notated at the top to stop on. You just go up as high as you'd like to go. Generally you do them on the upper strings. You can also do a latigo reversa, so down bow and descending. Usually you might do two strings at a time. They might could be fast or slower. And then there's also a really fun effect called perro, which means a dog. And you do two fast down glisses. Sounds like kind of like a dull dog barking. So you can experiment with latigo, whipping up and down on your fingerboard. Sirena is kind of like a slow gliss. You might hear, or you could even go up and down. I think that's what we would call the effect that they used in the Julio de Caro, the big glissando up and down. It's a siren, sirena. Lastly, I'll show you a couple of percussive effects. So this one is called the tambor or the drum. This one is a little bit harder to do. It's a little more individualistic, I should say. It's a little individual from instrument to instrument. But what I do is I put my hand in third position. I put my second and third fingers down on the G string. And then I pluck the C string. And I pluck it kind of to the side. Do you want to put your fingers on the string so that your fingernails are very close to the lower string? And then you can also do roll it. So you could do like three fingers. I gotta practice that one. I haven't done it in a while. So that's the tambor. It's a drum. Works best on the lower strings, and it works best when you have your strings are a little bit lower tension. Then finally, golpe de caja, which just literally means just hit the box. So you can hit with your thumb here, or you can hit the back of your instrument, wherever is easy and makes sense. This one is easy. You could go from playing to hitting. I'm not getting a great sound there. You have to kind of find the place on your instrument that works the best. And I'm trying not to beat my instrument up too much today. So I wanted to show you what these effects look like when you actually see them in the music. And this is a really great page of a score. This is from, I'm sorry, I'm covering up his name a little bit, Astor Piazzolla's Four for Tango, which was a famous piece written for the Kronos Quartet. And you'll see in this excerpt that, especially in this middle system, in the first violin part, there's the tambour, the drum, and then there's also in the second violin sandpaper. We go to from a lija sandpaper, and then a double latigo or whip. So that would sound. That's what that sounds like. The viola has these great descending. Glisses, and the cello gets an arrastre. This kind of motion. So lots of different effects, and that's what they look like in Four for Tango. Finally, one last effect, a melodic effect, is fraseo. So if you have you may see some just very plain, simple looking eighth notes or just the same note value on the music. But because of the tradition of the song, we know it's supposed to be phrased a certain way. So you might have that's the first, the kind of faster or closed version. And then the open version is maybe more like triplet. But whatever it is, it's not. It's not straight eighth notes. It's not regular eighth notes. It's not notated in the music. It like swing. That doesn't show you that. You just have to know the pieces. And you know these tango. Many of the classic tangos have been played for so many years. It's just been passed down like an oral tradition. This is kind of how you phrase these, and you just learned that as a part of your education. Now, we're violas, what can we play for the tango? I've already told you about the two Piazzolla pieces, but here's a whole list. There are many, many more. This is not by any means an exhaustive list, but if you want to take a screenshot, these are some pieces to get you started. I am really excited about the Miguel de Aguila new concerto and tango. It was written for cello, but he's done a viola version. And there's a piece by Glover Gill here called Ballade 3. This was a piece that is on the Waking Life soundtrack that we played. I just learned about a new one, Ezequiel Diz, this Fantasia Tanguera number 8, which is for viola and orchestra, but there's also a viola and piano version. And also I want to mention Roberto Molinelli. He's an Italian composer and arranger who wrote a wonderful viola concerto for Anna Sarova, which was premiered in 2017. That has a lot of tango influences throughout, but it has a big tango movement. The last tank movement is a tango movement. And then he also wrote Milonga para Astor for solo viola and cello with string orchestra. He also has, it's not an original composition, but he also has an arrangement of Adios Nonino, which is a very famous song of Astor Piazzolla's that he wrote when his father died, for solo viola, cello, and orchestra, string orchestra, which is fantastic. So I hope you'll check it out. I hope you'll be inspired. And I just wanted to share with you one last thought. Hopefully my screen isn't covering this too much, but I want to read this quote from Miguel del Aguila. The viola is rarely associated with the sound of tango, and yet I find it an ideal voice for it. Dramatic and expressive without being melodramatic, the viola sound has often a certain sadness, darkness, and sultriness, just like tango does. Well, I couldn't agree more with the composer, and I firmly agree, and I'm glad that Mauricio Marcelli agreed with me that the viola is definitely made to tango. And I hope you'll explore some of these compositions and techniques, and that I hope that you'll really enjoy it. Thank you.